Good afternoon, good evening, everyone. My name is Warawet Cholasins. I'm from the Asian Institute of Technologies, AIT, in Bangkok and in Thailand. So today we are going to have the web dialogue, a webinar, together with the APT, the Asia Pacific Telecommunity. So this web dialogue is organized by APT and AIT, in collaborations in order to provide the information and knowledge to the members and also non-members, so that we would like to give you some ideas about the trends of the technologies. So we are very glad that now we are having many people interested register in this web dialogue, and we are, you know, going to get connected from people around the world, only in the Asia Pacific region. So the topics today that we are going to start, the first webinar between APT and AIT, is on 5G's and IoT. So the application and policy solutions. We are organizing this one not only for the policy solution part, but also we open the ideas and open information, open the eyes to the corporate sector, so that, you know, both private sector and government sector and other sector can work together and, you know, fine tuning the interest on the technologies and also its trend that moving forward from today onward. So before we start this web dialogue, I first would like to invite Dr. Christopher Garnier, our Executive Director of AIT Extension of AIT, to welcome all participants. Dr. Chris.
Thank you, Kumbharat. Hello, my name is Dr. Chris Garnier. I'm the Executive Director of AIT Extension. And I welcome you to our webinar series. One thing that AIT Extension prides ourselves in is always bringing up-to-date, pertinent information that is applicable to those in the industry. And we have the opportunity to always bring up-to-date information, because we're not necessarily bound to what the schools are bound to. We can bring up-to-date information, as I said, and today is very much keen to that. We have the distinct privilege and opportunity to bring Mr. Masanori, the Secretary General of Asia Pacific Telecommunity, and as well as Dr. Phumphat. He is the Associate Professor of Optoelectronic Communication and Computational Systems from Bangkok University. Two gentlemen that whose expertise, it doesn't just go into the technical portion of it, but really goes into the policy applicable part and the managerial part of both 5G and IoT. It's our privilege always within our webinar series to bring gentlemen like this into the fold. Again, I'm honored to introduce them. I'm honored that they would be so willing to speak to our students, to our members, those that are associated with us. And I always look for you to continue to look at more webinar series that AIT Extension will bring to you again in the future. Again, thank you so much, gentlemen, for agreeing to be a part of this. And we look so forward to the immense plethora of intense information that I know that you will bestow upon our viewers. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Dr. Gonja. Thank you very much for your welcome remark for our participant, our audience. They are now coming today. You know, they are coming, 120 of them now, you know, coming to this event. And one of the persons in the team that we are organizing this web dialogue and webinar between APT and AIT is the top management of APT. He is the Secretary General of the Asia Pacific Telecommunities. So I would like to request Mr. Masanori Kondo to give the opening remarks for this web dialogue. Please, Mr. Kondo.
Hey, thank you, Kunjo, and thank you, Chris, for your remarks. And good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. I'm very pleased to welcome you all to this APT Web Dialogue on 5G and IoT applications and policy solutions. Today, 17th of May, is the World Telecommunications and Information Society Day as well. APT launched the APT Web Dialogue last year with the aim to provide a platform for discussion and sharing information, knowledge, and experiences. It is a flexible tool to serve APT members' needs for learning something new. You may call it APT's Brownback Lunch Program. This year, the first web dialogue is a collaboration with the Asian Institute of Technology, AIT, which is a prestigious university. APT plans to organize a series of dialogues with AIT in coming months. In addition to the collaboration with AIT, APT Web Dialogue will cover many interesting topics of ICT from the aspect of academia, policy, technology, and industry, which consists for APT and I in the future. So please keep eye on the APT website for the update. Finally, I'd like to express my sincere thanks to AIT for this great collaboration and support, and to the speaker and moderators for their contributions. I wish you all a fruitful event, and please stay healthy and safe. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kondo, and thank you for coming today to AIT studio. You know, it is very good that we start the first web dialogue, the webinar from AIT today, and we are honored to welcome your team to AIT this morning. Although during this pandemic, we cannot meet face to face, but we are next door in order to, you know, provide a good information for our audience. My dear audience, so as you know, that today's topic is one of the important topics in terms of the digital transformation trends in Asia Pacific, in other region. Actually, at the global level, we are looking at this, you know, the main, you know, backbone of the system, which is the 5G system, which is coming up, and also how these the 5G technologies will be also connected or linked with the technology which is related to IoT. And AIT and APT is very honored that we have the specialists from the 5G technology side, and we are working closely with, you know, the institution, the research center that working on these technologies in order to provide the support to not only the private sector and companies and corporate sectors, but also provide information and result of the research to the government sector so that these sectors, these organizations can also expand the knowledge through the form of the policy formulations, through the form of innovation, and also through the form of the commercialization of technologies. So the speaker of the topics today, I would like to introduce to you Associate Professor Phumphat Saeng Udomleut. So Associate Professor Phumphat Saeng Udomleut is our AIT adjunct professor. He is teaching in AIT in the subjects on telecommunication, and the expertise is on optoelectronics and computerizations. And Dr. Phumphat is also serving as the senior researcher at the Center of Research in Optoelectronics, Communication and Computational System at Bekpong University. He has the whole team, the researcher who can produce the research for innovation. So Dr. Phumphat, got his bachelor degree by having the King Scholarship from Thai government, from Thailand, to study in Prinsam University in 1996. And after that, you know, 5 years, 6 years afterward, he continued his master's degree and doctoral degree, PhD degree in the electrical engineering and computational science from MIT for master's degree and PhD. So he has a lot of experience. He used to work in the labs in the US. He is also teaching. He is teaching in AIT and many universities. He is doing research on the, you know, on the technologies which is related to the 5Gs. So without further ado, I would like to introduce and request Dr. Phumphat to start his talk and start his presentation. Dr. Phumphat, please.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Today, I will share with you my views on 5G and IoT. Okay, as mentioned by the introduction, like these technologies are important and they are potential solutions for a lot of things that will happen in the future development of the city and countries. I have prepared some slides to share with you. So I will talk about 5G technologies, IoT connectivities, and applications involving virtual reality or VR, augmented reality, AR, industrial automation, and smart cities. Let's start with visions from International Telecom Union, or ITU, on the use cases of 5G systems. As you can see, there's a wide range of applications that 5G can support. In the triangular diagram, the application icons are placed differently based on their requirements. For example, if we talk about high definition video streaming, then we are looking close to the top of the triangle, okay? Where the emphasis is on high data rates. And this transmission mode of 5G is called EMBB, okay, which stands for Enhanced Mobile Broadband. If we instead talk about industrial automation and self-driving cars, then we are looking at the bottom right of this triangle, where the emphasis is on low latency or low delay. Okay, this transmission mode is called URLLC, Ultra Reliable Low Latency Communications. If you're looking at connecting a large number of sensors for smart cities, then you're focusing on what is called MMTC, or Massive Machine Type Communication, which is in the bottom left of the triangle. Okay, you should keep in mind from looking at this picture that when you utilize heavily one aspect of 5G, you cannot expect to benefit as much from other aspects. For example, if you look at a large number of devices, okay, for smart city applications, then the MMTC mode of 5G can support up to 1 million devices per square kilometer. However, each of them will communicate with data rates in the order of kilobit per second. You cannot expect a million devices in the same area all communicating at gigabit per second, for example. Okay, so if you utilize heavily one aspect of 5G, some other aspects may not be achievable. So there's some trade-off in this triangle. Okay, you should not read that you can get everything from this triangle at the same time. Okay, so that's the first thing I want to share. Now, the next figure shows a typical 5G network architecture. Okay, a smartphone, a sensor device, or a robot can be viewed as a user equipment. Wireless transmissions between user equipment and base stations are performed in what is called a radio access network, or RAN. Okay, a backhaul network connects base stations to a 5G core network, which is then connected to the global internet. So the first thing I want to discuss is the EMBB mode of 5G. And this mode is about high data rate, okay? So we are talking about wireless transmissions at gigabit per second, which is quite an amazing achievement for wireless communication. And for most people, this is perhaps what they think of 5G the most, okay? 5G provides downlink and uplink peak data rates up to 20 gigabit per second for downlink and 10 gigabit per second for uplink. If you're not familiar, the peak data rate means that it means the rate that you can get if you are in a position with strong 5G signals, okay? And then there are nobody else around to share this bandwidth with you. That's the peak data rate. If peak data rate sounds too ideal for you, then you can perhaps think of average data rates. And the target values for 5G is an average of 100 megabit per second for downlink and 50 megabit per second for uplink. So do 5G systems meet these target values, you may ask? Well, the answer depends. It depends on which frequency bands are used for data transmissions. The frequency bands that 5G utilizes can be divided roughly into two regions. Okay, the first region lies below 6 gigahertz, okay, and is therefore called sub-6 gigahertz 5G. Okay, the second region lies above 24 gigahertz and is called the millimeter wave, since radio signals in this region have their wavelengths in the order of millimeter. So if you look at typical average download, downlink and uplink data rates in the table, okay, you can see that only the millimeter wave frequency band can provide up to the gigabit per second data rates. The data rates from the sub 6 gigahertz 5G band are significantly lower. This means that if you're looking for gigabit per second data rates, then the millimeter wave is necessary. So if you ask why are data rates much higher for millimeter wave? Well, first, a data channel in the millimeter wave band has 4 times as much bandwidth compared to a channel in the sub 6 gigahertz 5G band. And a higher bandwidth means a higher data rate for communication systems. In addition to more bandwidth, the use of multi-antenna beamforming, okay, can help boost the signal energy in the receiver direction. And this helps increase the data rate. When the receiver moves, the beam is adjusted to follow the receiver. The figure illustrates how the base station forms one beam for each user equipment. Okay, so you can see beams of different colors. That's just for illustration to emphasize that there are different beams to different user equipments. Beamforming for millimeter wave can be done electronically. So there is no mechanical movement. So it can be done quickly. Roughly speaking, data signal can be mapped to output signals to be transmitted on multiple antennas. If we use mapping function number one, then we can steer the beam in direction number one. If we instead use mapping function number two, then the beam direction can be adjusted. Okay, in this way, you can imagine how a beam can be formed to track the user location. Okay, so this is what millimeter wave is, how millimeter wave operates. So here are some average data rates in case you're interested in how fast you can do downloading and uploading these days. So these are some real world average data rates from United States of America in late 2020. And we can see that the average download speed is as high as 640 megabit per second. Okay, this is the average download speed. But this high download speed is from 5G millimeter wave. Okay, in comparison, if you use sub 6 gigahertz 5G, the average download speed is 63.9 megabit per second, which is much lower. Okay, however, it is still better than 4G and public Wi-Fi. What about upload? Well, for upload, millimeter wave 5G provides the average of 33.3 megabit per second, while sub 6 gigahertz 5G gives you around 14.1 megabit per second. Okay, so the for the upload, it's not as high, but thinking that we're mostly trying to download a lot of information, the system design tends to be this way, right? You can get higher download speeds compared to upload. But again, you can see how millimeter wave 5G provides a significantly higher rates than sub 6 gigahertz 5G, okay? So as a consumer, right, if you interestingly, if you go and buy 5G phones now, not all of them can use millimeter wave, okay? And this table shows some specifications of iPhone 12 Pro and iPhone 12 Pro Max phones. And you can see that besides the United States, right? The models sold in other countries do not support 5G millimeter wave, okay? And this is how you can see it, right? Because for United States, you can see that the frequency bands for the model includes the millimeter wave band above 24 gigahertz, okay? So this means that if you buy your iPhone 12 to use 5G, say in Thailand, where I now live, the phone won't be able to utilize millimeter wave 5G. And I cannot expect my data rate to be up to gigabit per second, okay? Currently in several countries, including Thailand, even though you have a millimeter wave 5G phone, there is no millimeter wave 5G service, okay? So in summary, if you want to have gigabit per second download speed, you have to check both the hardware of your phone as well as the service providers, whether or not they provide millimeter wave 5G. So the next question is, if millimeter wave 5G is good, it has much higher data rate than sub 6 gigahertz 5G. What about, why do we need sub 6 gigahertz 5G? Can we use just millimeter wave 5G? Okay, so this figure shows an important relevant fact. The transmission range of millimeter wave 5G is much smaller compared to sub 6 gigahertz 5G. It means that the millimeter wave signals may not reach where you are. If you're close to a millimeter wave base station, then you can use millimeter wave 5G and have your fast downloads. Otherwise, you may need to fall back to sub 6 gigahertz 5G, okay? Or even down to 4G if you're in the area where 5G is not yet available. The sub 6 gigahertz 5G band can be divided further into what is called mid-band, which refers to the frequency above 1 gigahertz, and then low band, which is the frequency below 1 gigahertz. Okay, so as lower frequencies means longer reach for radio signals, you can see that the lower the frequency, the larger the coverage. The previous figure was made by Qualcomm. Okay, you can see the same concept by T-Mobile, which is a mobile operator in the US. The layer cake, which is actually is a real cake, okay? They try to make something visual to manage customer expectations. So this so-called layer cake is made and used to inform customers that they cannot expect high speed download everywhere, okay? If you're close to the base station with 5G millimeter wave service, then you can expect fast download. Otherwise, you have to utilize lower download speeds, okay? So they want to make it visually clear for the customers. But this figure shows the coverage map of 5G. This is from Verizon in the United States. And this is access from the website just last week. And you can see the extent of 5G coverage. Okay, actually, the majority of the areas are covered with 4G LTE. It's in orange, right? 5G is in red. And you can see only patches of areas with 5G coverage. And if you talk about 5G millimeter wave, which is called 5G ultra wideband by Verizon, you can see very, very limited coverage with the millimeter wave 5G. And those are the red, dark red dots in the figure. Okay, so this is to give you an idea when people talk about 5G, currently they're not, I mean, the service is not available everywhere. So you have to be aware of this. And this is from the United States, but you can expect have similar trends in other countries when they start to deploy 5G, right? It will not be something overnight. It will have to be in phases, okay? So here's another look at how the coverage of millimeter wave 5G may be limited, okay? So the red areas mark strong signals reception. okay, around the base station. The green areas mark weak signal reception. Compared to sub 6 gigahertz 5G in the leftmost box, you can see that the coverage of millimeter wave 5G around the base station is much smaller. Right? So the second picture is for 28 gigahertz, and the coverage becomes smaller and smaller if you increase the frequency even higher and higher. Okay, so a single base station will not cover as large area compared to sub 6 gigahertz 5G in the leftmost figure. There are quite a number of real-world examples available on YouTube showing how easily we can lose millimeter wave signals in 5G, even in relatively open areas. In this example, the user can receive millimeter wave signals in the top picture, okay? But when he starts to step into a subway station, this one is in New York City, right? Even though he took only a few steps and there's still open sky above him, he already lost the millimeter wave signal in the bottom picture, okay? It means that there is quite a challenge in, you know, sending these millimeter wave signals to your smartphones when it comes to providing services. Now, in order to improve the millimeter wave coverage, there are a lot of ongoing research and developments, and researchers try to develop either passive reflectors or active repeaters of millimeter wave signals. And this figure is an illustration of the concept. Okay, the top left figure shows a scenario in which a VR user turned his head away from a millimeter wave access point, right? So when he's not looking at the access point, it turns out that his head is actually blocking the signal and you can have a signal loss, okay? In the top right figure, there's another scenario where the signal is cut off, and this time a VR user is raising his hand, perhaps to do something in the virtual world, but his hand is blocking the signal and so his service is cut off. So to help with this, if you have a repeater or a reflector somewhere, it provides an alternative path to the receiver, and the millimeter wave coverage should be more stable with this kind of technology. So you know, operators are looking into this kind of thing to improve the coverage of millimeter wave. Okay, so that's basically the first aspect of 5G, the aspect of high data rates. So to summarize so far, you can expect very fast downloading speed, but they're not everywhere. Okay, what about the second mode?
But sorry to interrupt. So before we move to the next part, we have two questions from the audience here.
Okay.
In relation to this technical aspect of what you have presented. So the first question is, in that case, how much mid-band spectrum should each operator has to meet the 5G average target of 100 megabyte per second?
How much mid-band spectrum
should each operator has to meet the 5G average target of 100 megabyte per second?
Okay. That is a question of network planning, right? And it is it depends on. It's hard to give a general answer on network planning because it depends on whether it's in the city, in the rural area, how many, what is the user density, and so on. Anyway, with proper network planning, right, and the target data rate of 100 megabit per second for download should be achievable for mid-band. We're not talking about gigabit per second. In fact, you should keep in mind that in the 4G systems, right? 4G is well known for 4G LTE, long-term evolution. But they actually have LTE Advanced, which is an advanced version of LTE. And for LTE Advanced, the data rate, the peak data rate is quoted to be up to gigabit per second, okay? But as I told you, it's probably too ideal to talk about peak data rate. We should talk about average data rate. So the technology is there, and I think with proper network planning, you can do it. But how much spectrum, how much bandwidth you need, it depends on the density, the user density. Okay.
Thank you very much. Yeah. So the second one, quickly. What is average coverage radius of mm wave signal?
Okay. What is the average radius?
Yes. Of the millimeter wave signal.
From my readings and studying, it's about in the order of like a few hundred meters. Okay, based on what I see. But I think what is more important than the distance, it seems to be the need for line of sight, meaning that you need to have some open part, right, for the signal to propagate directly from base station to your device. And the need for line of sight seems to be a real challenge, not just the distance. Okay.
Thank you very much. So may I request all the audience, if you have any questions or any comments or questions, please put that into the chat box or question and answer box, please. So Dr. Pumpat, thank you very much. So please continue. Thank you.
Okay. So the next aspect of 5G is URLLC. So just to remind you, U is for ultra reliable and double L is for low latency. So for reliability, the target is to have 10 to the minus 5 packet loss or below. In other words, it means you should lose no more than one packet out of 100,000 transmit packets, okay? And the target latency or delay is 1 millisecond or below. That's the target, okay? So how are they achieved? Well, they are achieved through a combination of different techniques. And I will talk about techniques in the wireless part, as well as the techniques in the wireline part. In the wireless part, right, the 5G new radio standard defines the data frame, okay, to be containing time slots that is shorter than 1 millisecond. In comparison, the smallest time unit in 4G system is 1 millisecond. So in 4G system, if you want to transmit anything, it will take at least 1 millisecond or more because the smallest time unit is 1 millisecond. In contrast, for 5G, the transmission time unit is defined to be as low as 125 microseconds. This is in the bottom right. So you can imagine that it is possible to transmit data in less than 1 millisecond. So this is the first technique in the wireless part. Now, in the wireless part, there is also the concept of grant-free multiple access. So to understand what grant-free means, consider the left figure, which illustrates what is called grant-based transmissions. Okay? In a grant-based transmission, if a user equipment wants to transmit anything, it must send a request to the base station. And the base station must reply with some grant message before the transmission can happen. And this exchange of message would take time, right? So to remove this time and make it faster, people talk about grant-free transmission, which is on the right-hand side. And in the grant-free mode, user equipment can just transmit the message without trying to get a grant. So this will reduce the time. However, there is a chance of packet collisions, right? If there are multiple devices trying to do this thing at the same time. So to overcome possibility of packet collisions, each packet is transmitted multiple times, okay? So that probabilistically, one of them will get through with high reliability. So this scheme is called K-repeat grant-free transmission. So with this, the latency or the delay could be made smaller, okay? So I've just described how sub-millisecond transmissions are possible in the wireless part of 5G. What about the wireline part? Okay, first, there's a distinction between what is called 5G non-standalone on the left side and 5G standalone on the right side. Okay, it turns out that some implementation of 5G only implement 5G in the radio access part, and the core network is still based on 4G network, okay? But the full-fledged implementation of 5G would be 5G standalone on the right. The core network is also based on 5G technologies. Does it have any impact? There is some survey results on latency Okay, this one is also from the US back in late 2020. And the results shows some difference in terms of the latency when you use non-standalone on the left and standalone on the right, both in urban areas and rural areas. So standalone 5G is a little bit faster. Okay, unfortunately, this result doesn't show exact values of the latency, and it just shows relative value. But you can see that with the standalone version, the delay is somewhat smaller compared to the non-standalone version. Okay, but perhaps more significant improvement in the delay reduction is going to be obtained from something called mobile edge cloud, okay, which is one type of edge computing. Imagine if you use an application server somewhere deep in the cloud, right? The propagation path from your user equipment, okay, will follow the green path on the top, right? If you have to go to the radio access part, and then you have to go through several steps in the core, in the wireline part, before it reaches the cloud and then gets a reply back. All this can take a lot of time. Actually, the delay in the wireline network part can be much higher than 1 millisecond. So to cut delay in the wireline part, you can imagine having a mobile edge cloud, right? Located close to the radio access networks, and your application servers could be moved or duplicated, okay, in the mobile edge cloud. So the propagation path for your signal now, okay, is the red one below. And you can see that this is a much shorter path, and then it helps reduce the latency, okay, to be closer to the target. So at this point, you may wonder why 1 millisecond. After all, human reaction time is about 250 milliseconds. Does it, we need something that fast? Well, it turns out that this low latency can support communication among machines, okay, not just for us humans, and such as in coordination of robots. And this is a video clip that I like to share, okay, about how 5G can improve robot coordination. It is okay if you don't hear the sound, because I will explain. So in this example from Nokia, robot coordinates to basically balance the ball so that the ball is kept in the center of the tray, okay? And now the demonstrator will switch to 5G technologies, and there is a measure of the latency. And you can see the drop to a millisecond level. And then with the new 5G-based coordination, right, this balancing can be achieved much faster. And this is a comparison between 5G and 4G. Okay, and you can see the how the job is done much more quickly, okay, with 5G communications among robots. Okay, what about some latency results from real-world operators? So these are some results from the mobile cloud gaming community, okay, in London back in October 2020. And for the, since we are focusing on latency, right? So we can just focus on the third column from the right, latency. And as you can see that as of now, the best latency, the smallest latency is 17 milliseconds, okay? Which is still above the 1 millisecond target. Unfortunately, there's no breakdown on these latency values. So we don't know how much is from the radio access network and how much is in the wireline core network, okay? But anyway, so these are the current value. It's still not quite, you know, 1 millisecond, which is the target value, but it is sufficient for several applications, okay? Now I want to turn to the application on virtual reality and augmented reality. For these applications, to prevent motion sickness, okay, it is accepted that you need the latency below 20 milliseconds. And from the last slide, you saw that 17 milliseconds was achieved, right? So it's not quite 1 millisecond, but in the order of 20 milliseconds is sufficient for VR and AR. Okay, so besides low latency, which is provided by 5G, another aspect that 5G can help VR and AR is the possibility to perform graphic rendering in the cloud. So if you're not familiar what rendering is, this picture shows an example of rendering. Okay, on the left, this is a 3D model of a house. And on the right is the result from rendering. Basically, rendering is a process of assigning color pixels to make the output look realistic. Okay, so this is a time-consuming process and it requires a lot of computational power and expensive hardware. So with 5G, okay, with the high throughput, it's possible to move rendering, which is now typically done at the user device, okay, which is emphasized in the top picture. It is possible to move where rendering is done from the user device to the cloud, right? If the rendering is done in the cloud, then the user device no longer has to have hardware to do this. But then there is a need for high speed, okay, data channel, right? Because after rendering, the network will have to send high definition screens, right? The image to the user device. And without 5G, this may be difficult, but with the 5G speeds, you can do it. And by moving rendering to the cloud, the good thing is that you can expect the headsets of VR and AR to be lighter, okay, and also cheaper, because you no longer need to have this expensive hardware in the device. So on the left side, you can see that the current VR and AR headset will look a little bit bulky, okay? Now, this is the current headset that is compatible with 5G, but it's still big because they also made it backwards compatible with 4G and Wi-Fi, right? But in the future, right, people expect headsets to be more, to be lighter and cheaper, as you can see some examples on the right-hand side, okay? Now, the VR and AR application extends beyond gaming. Okay, you can imagine remote medical operations, visually guided machine maintenance, as well as professional trainings. And I like to show one example of machine maintenance. And this is an example of how you can make use of AR to help, okay? So you can see that with augmented reality, you can actually show visually what to do next when you maintain a machine, right? You can follow basically step by step the visual instructions, and this can be very effective. And you can see now there's a second person holding a screen, right? But imagine if 5G helps reduce the size of the screen involved, right? You can imagine that the repair person is wearing some kind of smart glasses and he can see on his glass the information from these steps, right? So there is no need for the second person, perhaps in the future. Now, to follow the application, so beyond these VR and AR applications, right? The feature of 5G is used to support industrial automation, and 5G-based smart factories typically expect to utilize all modes of 5G, right? The EMBB mode for high data rates will allow the use of AR-based applications in smart factories, and URLLC mode, which is a low latency, right? Together with the mobile edge cloud, okay? Could support robot controls and warehouse management, right? And the third mode, which I will describe later on, the MMTC mode, will support connecting a lot of sensor devices, and they are good for environment and safety monitoring in smart factories. Okay, all these can help enable industrial automation. And if you wonder, is 5G being used? Is it mature enough to provide industrial automation? I'd like to share a clip, and this is based on the Qingdao port in China. Okay, and this clip will show you what can be achieved with 5G technologies. So this is the fully automated port, meaning that you won't see any workers, okay? And it can operate at night, even in complete darkness. But then there's a mention of the super brain, okay, that controls all these things. So this is a large scale industrial automation. I cannot imagine easily to find a larger example, okay? So the communications are based on 5G technologies. Okay, due to the time limitation, I will not show the full video. Okay, so only to give you specific ideas of the maturity of 5G technology. So so in terms of industrial automation provided by coordination of these robots and machines to 5G, okay, there are existing examples in real world. Okay, so it's not something that is still in the future. Okay, it is here with us as we talk. Anyway, the one thing that we should note from the video clip is that for complex industrial automation, actually it's not, I mean, while 5G is a sufficient communication infrastructure, it's not everything. In the video clip, you also see the emphasis of what is called the big brain, right? And that refers to the use of servers as well as algorithms. Okay, so algorithms is going to be an important part if you talk about industrial automation. And it's a big topic, and I don't think I will be able to discuss the algorithms part today. Okay, it deserves to be a different talk in itself, okay? Because algorithms may involve the use of artificial intelligence and machine learning, and these are something that you should keep in mind, that in conjunction with 5G, there would be other supporting technologies for industrial automation. Okay, so now I want to turn to the last mode of 5G, okay? And it is called MMTC, which stands for Massive Machine Type Communication. Okay, MMTC makes 5G one candidate for what is called low power wide area networks. And such networks are used to support various IoT applications. Okay, so for target, typical target values for MMTC, basically the device density is up to 1 million devices per square kilometer. Battery life of each device should be 10 years or higher. The latency is expected to be 10 seconds. This is for 20 byte packets. Right, so you have to keep in mind that we're not aiming for speeds here, right? We're aiming for basically supporting a large number of devices, right? For example, in smart farms or smart cities, okay? Now, in terms of the technical approaches for 5G, it turns out MMTC will support two techniques that were actually implemented for 4G systems, but both are considered, you know, good technologies and potentially they could support the target values. So they are also adopted to be in the 5G framework. And these two technologies are narrowband IoT and LTEM, which stands for long-term evolution for machines. Okay. So what are the differences? NB-IoT will use a lower channel bandwidth So therefore, the data rates that are support will be lower, right, in the order of a few 10 kilobit per second, as opposed to 1 megabit per second for LTE-M. Both types of devices have battery lives of 10 years or more, okay? Narrowband IoT can support only data, but LTE-M will support both data and voice. And the frequency band that narrowband IoT can use is flexible. It could be in the LTE channel or in the guard band, okay, between LTE channels, or even in the GSM band, because the channel bandwidth is less than one GSM channel. So if you have 2G systems that are no longer, you know, if you stop the service of 2G systems, you can imagine using these 2G channels to support narrowband IoT, okay? And there are a few studies which provide evidence that narrowband IoT or LTE-M can meet the targets for massive machine type communication. That's why they belong to the 5G family too, okay? Why are so many devices, I mean, if you wonder about how so many devices supported on a single channel, for example, Ericsson performed a simulation that indicates that up to 200,000 devices can be supported on a single channel. If you wonder how can a single channel support so many devices, well, first of all, each channel is subdivided into something smaller, into smaller units, right? 15 kilohertz for downlink, 3.75 kilohertz for uplinks. So there is a subdivision of a channel into sub-channels, often called sub-carriers. And each sub-carrier can be shared, okay? Each sub-carrier can be shared among many, many devices using the process called random access. Another thing to keep in mind is that not every device will be active at the same time. So only a fraction of devices are active and transmitting at the same time. So with all these things together, a single channel can be used to support many, many devices, up to 200,000 devices, okay, in the study. Now, if you wonder, what about 1 million devices as a target value? Well, if one channel can support this many devices, you can double the number of channels, you can increase the number of channels, and more devices can then be supported. Now, 5G system inherits some technologies, right, from narrowband IoT and LTE-M, but at the same time, there are ongoing research and development of trying to, you know, implement further technologies to improve the spectral efficiency. And one technology is called NOMA, which stands for non-orthogonal multiple access. And this is a system which, you know, the same frequency channel and same time slot can be used to transmit data to multiple devices. Okay? And in this, you can imagine that the data signal and transmit simultaneously to two devices, but with different power levels. The device with a higher signal power can receive the data by viewing the other devices as noise. And this device is the user equipment tool in the figure. Okay, the device with lower signal power, which is user equipment one in the figure, you first detect the other device signal and then use it to subtract the original received signal before detecting its own data. And this process is called successive interference cancellation, or SIC. Okay, so with this kind of technology, you can further improve the efficiency of the using the channel for machine type communications. Well, so far, what I've discussed about is 5G. But when we talk about connectivities for IoT, there's a wide range of technologies to choose from, right? The connectivities we discussed so far is located at the top right, which is cellular-based, okay? Cellular IoT can provide large coverage ranges, which is the horizontal axis, as well as high data rates, which is the vertical axis. However, they are considered more expensive. And one reason is because they're using license spectrums, right? And operators have to pay usually pretty heavy fees for the license. Alternative technologies are available, right? They are referred to as non-cellular IoT technologies. And for the same range of coverage as the cellular technologies, two well-known alternatives are LoRa and Sigfox, okay? So let me mention LoRa and Sigfox. So the LoRa with the network support is called LoRaWAN, which stands for Long Range Wide Area Network. Okay, and Sigfox is the name, it's a specific name. Both use unlicensed frequency bands. And the difference is that Sigfox use a lower channel bandwidth, meaning the data rate will be lower. As you can see, it's in the order of 100 bit per second as compared to 10 kilobit per second, okay, order of 10 kilobit per second for all of them. And the frequency of message transmission for Sigfox is limited. The range are similar. The battery life are similar. Okay, they are both going to be more than 10 years, okay? So this provides alternative technologies for IoT compared to cellular based. However, when you use technologies like LoRaWAN, there is a need for gateway equipment, right? And this gateway, you basically you receive signals from your sensor devices and then transfer the information to the application server in the network somewhere. But you need these gateway devices to connect between your device and the network, okay? If we compare between cellular IoT and non-cellular alternative, right, you can see that the alternatives of cellular IoT is the seamless connectivity because from your device, you can, with a SIM card, for example, you connect directly to the operator network, which is automatically connect to the internet, right, to your server. You don't need to set up gateways. You can expect higher data rates and lower latency, okay? But advantages of non-cellular IoT, as I mentioned, is they are using unlicensed frequency bands. So the device costs are typically lower and they tend to have longer battery lives from the study, okay? So there's pros and cons. It depends on the user situation, which technology should be used. I want to basically end my discussion with the discussion of smart cities. And this is going to be the last application that I discuss, okay, given the limited time that I have today. When we talk about smart cities, there's a wide range of objectives, right? It covers infrastructures, utilities, transportation systems, environment, and also something that is not entirely technical, like e-government, as well as people's well-being, okay? When we talk about smart cities and IoT applications, one thing you should keep in mind is it's not only about machines or devices, it's also about people, okay? So if you're wondering what kind of things are available in smart cities right now, I like to take an example of Singapore, because Singapore is ranked number one based on the smart city index out of 109 cities around the world, okay? So in Singapore, they have like driverless public transportation. I'm talking about public transportations, not just private cars, okay? So taxis and buses are included, smart homes, digital surveillance by the police, okay? Service robots, smart streets with sensors on the lampposts, okay? And then e-government application that allow people to do everything related to the government from home, as well as heavy use of VR and AR. So these are all the things that exist, okay, for Singapore, which is considered the smartest city as of now, okay? And finally, I want to show the video clip about how Singapore is planning, okay, to have what is called the digital twin of the city. Okay, a digital twin is basically a model, a virtual model that capture what is going on in the real city. But once you have the data in the model, what you can do is you can start to simulate to see the effects of different kind of management policy that you may have on the city itself, okay? So they have an ambitious plan to basically virtualize everything in the city and create some model, okay, to understand and do some study, case study scenarios on the city, okay? Now, this kind of studies will involve, first of all, connectivities, of course, for IoT sensors and so on. It will involve certainly algorithms if you want to control various parts of the city, but also new requirements will come, right? Because you are involving a lot of data. So another keyword is data analytics, right? Big data, for example. This would be something that you have to deal with, okay? And lastly, because I mentioned people, right? It's not just about machine. So for smart cities, you know, you probably talk about mobile applications to interact with the human users, okay? Okay, so this is all I want to share with you today. This is a big topic, and I'm sure I did not discuss a lot of things that you may expect to hear, and due to the time limitation, okay, I have to cover things rather broadly. But I hope that at least I was able to give you some technical insights, okay, about what underlies the service that 5G provides so that you have a better view of 5G today. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Phumphat. It's really, really interesting, not only from the viewpoints of technical parts of these presentations, because these technical parts of the presentation, those who know about technical things, they can really see and also interpret in a way that they can do something in relation to that, or maybe they can think of some further knowledge and also the practical knowledge about that. And also the second part is about the possible applications of these, the 5G tech. There are a lot of detailed elements that have some effect to the innovations and further technologies and future use, and also the platform at the end or in between that maybe the business can develop in order to serve the user, so on and so forth. And also the applications in the large scale, like in the factories, in the port and all of that, I think. And at the end is about the large city, the big city, the smart city. So I think these are properly really presented and very comprehensive, give a lot of information there. It depends on how the audience as the user to make use of this information. So before I go further, I would like to present the four questions, which is I can see from the screen now. Mm-hmm. So the questions to you is, thank you very much for organizing these useful sessions. I want to ask Professor Phumphat about the availability of 5G service by recently developed satellite-based internet service provision like Tesla and HAPS 30 by SoftBank. Would these 5G technologies be available from satellite-based services unlike the ground-based stations?
Actually, I have to admit that I don't know the answer to that question. Okay, so sorry, I did not, I'm not aware of the development, I mean, the activities enough to provide you with insights. Okay, so I have to pass this one, sorry.
That is no problem. So we can move to the next question. What experience speed should be for indoor?
Can you repeat the question? What would something?
Okay, what experience speed should be for indoor?
Okay, indoor. So talking about indoors, right?
Right, yep. Right.
Okay, so the question is about speeds for indoor. Well, it depends on whether or not service providers would set up some access points or base stations which are indoor, right? So as I mentioned before, a significantly higher speeds can be obtained from the millimeter wave. So if the indoor access point provide millimeter wave connectivities, then you can expect very high data rate, okay? Otherwise, the data rate will have to fall back to sub 6 gigahertz 5G, as I mentioned before. So I think it depends on whether or not the access points are there, okay? So this one you have to check. You have to check the service provider. However, if you think of developing a project and you work in coordination with the service provider, right? I can imagine that they would be willing to help, you know, set up some kind of access point close by, and then you can expect high speed. Okay, if you want to demo some very fancy virtual reality applications and so on, then I think indoor or outdoor is not a problem. The problem is more like whether you or not you have the access point or base station close by. Okay.
Thank you very much. So the next question is, what is the biggest resistance when deploying OpenWhite 5G network? What is the biggest resistance when deploying OpenWhite 5G network?
OpenWhite 5G. I'm not sure what is meant by OpenWhite 5G, but in general, I think, I mean, if you talk why people don't deploy 5G everywhere, it's a question of cost, right? Because it involves, I mean, 5G is a new system. You need to install basically new equipment everywhere. And if you talk about millimeter wave, the maybe you're wondering why it's not installed everywhere. Well, it costs quite a lot because, as I mentioned, the coverage area is much, much smaller compared to the existing frequency band, right? So you're talking about maybe having to install 10 times or more the number of base stations around the city to provide like full coverage. So I think it's the cost, okay? But so operators may decide to install basically in phases. So in the first phase, they may focus on really dense area in the city, right? But as they have more revenues and technology become more mature and cheaper, they may start to expand the coverage little by little.
Thank you. So next and last question in the chat box is, if we combine the millimeter wave AP backhaul with Wi-Fi 6E last mile, would that be a better solution from technical point of view?
I think the combination technologies will still exist, right? You can see even among 5G technologies itself, right? You expect, remember the picture of the layer cake, you expect that it's not just one particular frequency band, right? And of course, if you have a high-speed Wi-Fi, there's no reason why, you know, when you go to your home, you should not connect to Wi-Fi instead of a cellular system, right? So I think the combination of technologies is always a good idea because it can optimize the performance of your system, right? When we talk about IoT for smart cities and for smart farms and so on, remember I mentioned cellular-based and non-cellular-based IoT, right? You can also think of the combination, right? Because imagine if you have a lot of sensors out there, I mean, it's going to cost, you have to pay for subscription fee if you use cellular-based technology, right? If you have a lot of sensors, the cost can add up and it will become expensive. Instead, you could have a combination, right? So some sensors may be based on non-cellular IoT, but then some sensors, some points could be cellular-based, and you can basically aggregate your data and send over the cellular system if you want to rely on cellular IoT for connectivities. So some kind of combination is always helpful, in my opinion, okay? And even for 5G, right, you can think about perhaps hotspot, right? When you move, when you're on the bus, right, when you travel between dense areas, you can imagine that you use sub-6 gigahertz 5G. But when you reach a popular location, then you have hotspot of millimeter wave, right? So some kind of combination of usage are expected. Okay, I don't think you can expect a single technology to dominate, okay? Because you know, if you're sitting at home, you're using your Wi-Fi, at least you don't have to share the bandwidth with the people around you, okay? You don't have to share as much, okay?
Thank you, sir. So one more, how 5Gs and IoT can be better utilized in industrial supply chain management? Is there any example in our region or in Thailand about this one?
So the question is how
the 5G and IoT together of these two technologies can be utilized in industrial supply chains.
In the supply chain. Well, there are a lot of automations in the supply chain that I can think of. For example, warehouse management. And I had a chance to you know, discuss with people who are working on like automatic guided vehicle, AGV, which you know, move boxes in and out of the warehouse. I can imagine how 5G can be used to basically help make the connection stability higher, right? Because they often tell me that with current technology, sometimes the robots are not acting, you know, the way they should be. Sometimes there's some delay. So 5G technologies can reduce such delay because of the low latency, right? So you can imagine a more stable operation. But the other aspects of the logistic and management, as I mentioned, has to do with algorithms, okay? And this is beyond 5G. And I think 5G will help, 5G and IoT will help with the communication infrastructures. But really, the question to your answer would be, you have to consider the algorithms involved as well.
Thank you. So thank you very much. So I have one question, which is I guess everybody also have the same questions. Mm-hmm. So how do we start from here? I mean, as we representing the key players in telecommunication, you know, industries and business and service and academics, how do we start? How we start from the research point of view, how we are going to start from the point of view of the universities, the businesses, the industries, and the government. How do we start, Ajahn?
Personally, well, as a university professor, I started by trying to get a government grant on the use of 5Gs, because 5G is relatively new in Thailand, where I now live, right? So, but if we get some project, we can collaborate with operators, right? And operators, you know, if they cooperate with us, they will be willing to set up the infrastructure for you to test, okay? That's how you can start. But if you are, say, from the, like, as a company and so on, you can actually do the same thing. Actually, in many countries, I think the open calls for sponsored projects are not limited to just universities, right? They are open for companies as well. In terms of the individual, right? If you just want to test, well, then you have to check with your operators, right? As I mentioned, not everything is available. Like in Thailand, I cannot expect a millimeter wave download speeds right now. So, but companies may have what they call the you know, some centers, some innovation centers and so on. And for example, Thailand, you know, the companies often have some demo houses and the innovation parks that they have. And if you go and talk to them, maybe they'll be happy to let you try, okay? But I think it's important to try it out because it's still new technology. And people say a lot of things, right? And sometimes the test results do not quite match what people claim. So I think it's good to test it out before you invest anything heavily in using the 5G technologies.
Can you tell us, I mean, from your maybe rough assessment of the infrastructure that the countries in ASEAN have the, at this moment, and if we can see from your presentation as our dream in the future, so how can we reach that at that point where what is about our infrastructure now, which is in our countries in ASEAN? Do we have any idea on that?
Yeah, I think, well, ASEAN is interesting because it's a mix of the countries with the different levels of technology penetration, right? As I mentioned, Singapore is considered the smartest city of 109 cities around the world. But then you still have some perhaps rural areas in Thailand where there's no internet connectivity and so on. So it's I think one of the challenge is this wide gap, okay, of connectivities. And to me, personally, I think, you know, when we have nice technologies, we should try to make it available as widely as possible. And in the ASEAN context, I think this is one challenge that, you know, we should all help. And, you know, people can improve their standard of living sometimes quite a lot if they have access to technologies, right? There are examples of how farmers can, you know, bypass some middlemen, and they can actually sell their crops directly and make better livings. I think there are a lot of chances for technologies to help in terms of the ASEAN context. But personally, I would like to see that the disparity being narrow.
Doctor, so maybe you have another 30 seconds to maybe say what is the key takeaway from today's discussion? What you would like to take away? You asked for us to take away from that.
Okay. So actually my main goal that I want from this talk is that hopefully I give you some of the technical aspects of how 5G deliver those nice service to you. Okay, I hope that at least you get some ideas. Okay, that it's not just happening by magic. There are some technical approaches underneath, and when you understand to some degree these technical that underlie the service, hopefully you can make a better decision. Okay, you can have a more realistic expectation from these technologies, and you know, as I say, make a better decision for your project, okay? And I wish you, everyone, all the success if you plan to use these kind of technologies in your organizations.
Few words from Dr. Chris. Dr. Chris.
Professor Phompot, hey, I learned so much from you. I could not be more grateful myself and my own ignorance of 5G and IoT, and me being a novice, I sat and I was just taking scrupulous notes of really being in awe of the plethora of information that you provided. Again, thank you so much, sir, for being here and teaching our audience. And last but not least, Mr. Masanori, sir, thank you so much again for this collaborative the collaboration with AIT and AIT Extension. We're just looking forward to more opportunities to work with you, sir. Again, grateful on behalf of our entire institution. Thank you so much, gentlemen.
And Mr. Masanori Kondo, please.
Yeah, thank you. Just like what Dr. Kliss mentioned, I also learned a lot from Professor Phompot. Then thank you very much for that. And as APT, as I said at the very beginning, we will continue to this kind of dialogues. So our superintendent will put a URL link for our surveys. So please respond to those surveys so that we can reflect and we can improve our web dialogue in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So as Mr. Kondo said, you know, we will distribute the survey to all of you so that Your feedback will be very, very important. And if you are interested in other topics that APT and AIT can organize, we are happy to find the expert persons around the world to talk to you and give you information on this one. So with this, I would like to thank Mr. Kondo from APT, the Secretary General of APT, by giving us opportunity to have this joint webinar together. Thanks, Dr. Chris, for joining today's event with us and also meeting the audience. And thank you, you know, staff of APT. Thank you, my staff from AIT Extension and from AIT. And also thanks, Dr. Phumphat, for your very nice presentation, for your nice material and also knowledge that you are providing for us. Last but not the least, we have to thank the audience for being with us almost 2 hours. And we are really hopeful that you are getting very good information to digest further, to talk about it further, and feel free to contact APT and AIT if you need any assistance, any help. We will try our best to provide you the assistance. So until we see you next time of the web dialogue, thank you very much and bye-bye for now. Thank you.